Hi everyone, buyer's agent Jay Pace here for Providence Property Group with a market update for the month that was August 2022. Now, today I wanted to change it up a little bit, talk about something really exciting. No, not cars, not luxury watches, not even sport. Today we're going to talk about land tax. Now, there's been a controversial change to the calculation of Queensland land tax, which will impact Queensland landowners from the 30th of June 2023. The reason these changes are controversial is that the Queensland local government will review the overall value of the land a taxpayer owns and use this information to calculate the rate of land tax that will be applied to the share of Queensland land in the overall value of their land holdings. Now, I tried to write that paragraph so many different ways, but I think you say land about 15 times. Queensland land, land tax. So it's a state-based tax that will calculate my land tax based upon the investment properties that I hold nationally. I wonder why this is controversial. Firstly, owner occupiers, your properties are exempt from this land. So if you have an owner occupier property, let's say in Sydney, that's worth, I don't know, 3 million bucks, give or take, something like that, and you've got some investment properties in Queensland, they won't count your owner occupier property within that calculation. So for most people, it's going to be okay in regards to that aspect, okay? Now, I'm going to do a more in-depth video as many organizations oppose this legislation, including the Real Estate Institute of Queensland. I would assume that there's going to be some changes or definitely some more information that's going to come out about this. This particular land tax has the potential to discourage investment in Queensland and put further pressure on an already worsening rental crisis. So there's no other state or territory, by the way, that charges state and land taxes based on the value of properties held across Australia. They usually stick within their jurisdiction. Some basic things that you need to know: land tax is based on the land value of the property, not the total value of the property. I've got a lot of clients come to me straight away going, oh, but my property's worth $1.2 million. Like, yeah, but what's the land worth? So we've got to figure out what your land is worth first to get a better understanding of that calculation. The current tax-free thresholds are $600,000 for individuals and $350,000 worth of land for companies and trustees. Speak to your accountant. They're probably not across all of this yet because it is brand new and it won't apply until next year, but have a chat with your accountant. The Reserve Bank of Australia has again lifted the official cash rate for the fifth straight month. So the RBA Governor Philip Lowe announced an increase of another 50 basis points, taking us from a cash rate of 1.85% to a new rate of 2.35%. Like many economists, I'm a little surprised at the aggression displayed by the RBA with these 50 basis point jumps. The board emphasized that it may increase interest rates over the months coming, but it's not a preset path. In other words, we don't know what the hell we're doing, and we're going to keep pushing rates up until we see what happens. We got no clue. That's basically what's happening. And there's been a lot of outcry about people saying, what's the RBA doing here? Now, I think it's interesting, though, if we put this into perspective, we take the emotion out of it, to see what the 10, 20, and 30-year average cash rates are and how they compare to where we are today. So you can see the 10-year average is about 2.56. So we're currently at 2.35. So we're close to that 10-year average. The 20-year average is 3.94, and the 30-year average is 4.99. All right? Again, and I was going to put this in the presentation, but it just takes too long to show you all the articles. There's a lot of banks that are dropping their rates, though. A lot of banks are dropping their 10-year, 3-year, 5-year fixed loans. So speak to your mortgage broker about that and see what you can do. This is the rolling 3-month change in dwelling values for our state capitals, and we can see a further decline in Sydney and Melbourne, I mentioned this about 3-4 months ago that we're going to see the biggest declines in that in those two markets. Brisbane's now joining the party, down 2.5% over the past quarter. Remember though, Brisbane and Adelaide increased by almost 30% last year. So this, by all means, is not the end of days, all right? Adelaide and Perth are also starting to soften now, but not yet in negative territory. Now let's take a look at the winners and the losers for the month. Australian dwelling values fell by 1.6% as a whole in July, making it the fourth consecutive month that CoreLogic's National Home Value Index has fallen. Every capital city apart from Darwin has had negative monthly growth, with a similar scenario playing out across the rest of the state regions, where only regional South Australia recorded an increase in housing values for the month. Despite the recent weakness, housing values across most regions remain well above their pre-COVID levels. So home values in all capital cities and the rest of the states, bar Melbourne, remaining 15% or that above the levels recorded in March 2020, okay? Implying that most homeowners have significant equity buffer before their home is likely to be worth less than what they paid for it, or what they call negative equity, okay? A few years back, we did a short 2-minute video on our tips for buying in a cooling market when it adjusts and shifts from being a seller's market to becoming a buyer's market. Jump onto our website, our YouTube channel, have a look at this video by Linton Stevenson. It's just called Providence Buying Tips, 5 Reasons to Negotiate Harder. I'll place a link in the description of this video below, okay? Now, according to CoreLogic's head of research, Tim Lawless, a 15% peak to trough decline would roughly take CoreLogic's combined capital index back to March 2021 levels, Mr. Lawless said. Additionally, many homeowners would have had at least a 10% deposit and paid down a portion of their principal. The risk of widespread negative equity remains low. So what he's saying there is, even if we get a 15% drop, okay, property prices will still be as expensive as they were 18 months ago. Listen, it's attractive, because if you were back 18 months ago and knew what was going to happen 18 months into the future, you'd be like, prices are cheap, I'm going to buy. But it's still expensive. Some people want to wait for this basically to happen. I disagree with that strategy. People going, well, I'm going to wait for the market to come down. What's going to be for sale during that time, by the way, if the market comes down? And that's if the market comes down to 15%. What's the competition going to be like too on good property? Typically, it's going to be strong. And how much will you be able to borrow if the RBA continues to put their rates up? You might find the perfect property, but the bank's going to turn around to you and say, hey, we're actually not going to lend you the money for this property. Now, to those people playing the long game, like me, I say the odds are in our favor. This is a 30-year chart of houses and unit values since 1992 across the combined capital cities. And we can see over 450% increase in houses and over a 300% increase in units. I wanted to take a quick moment actually today to talk about something that's really important. We live in a fast-paced world. Most people don't have time to think, and this has undoubtedly resulted in many people allowing the news to do their thinking for them. I've said it many, many times, the media's job is not to inform, it's to influence, okay? We've been seeing a lot of alarming headlines since interest rates started rising in May, but trusting headlines is not the best way to stay informed. Recent studies show that out of every 10 people that read a headline, only about 2 of them will read the actual article, and that's really dangerous. I was reviewing some research which suggested that the digital information era has dropped a human's attention span from 12 seconds, which is what it was around 2000, to now just 8 seconds. So that's a 30% reduction in attention spans in 22 years. And this is an all-time low figure, and it's even less than your average pet goldfish's attention span, which, for the record, is 9 seconds. So, how does a human's shortening attention span contribute to our likelihood of not reading past the headlines and thus making an uninformed opinion? We think that we don't have time to read an entire article. And if the headline aligns with our preconceived notion of reality, then we'll agree with it. And we'll maybe even share it. Not necessarily sharing the article online or something, but just share that information with our friends and family as a means of reinforcing our entrenched beliefs. So let's take a look at some headlines here, because I collect headlines. Every time I see some of these pop up on my social media, I screenshot that stuff straight away. And the reason I do that is because I like to look back and remember when we saw such outrageous stuff. Google is awesome. I love Google because I love being able to type in a headline or type in a subject and look at what the market was saying about it 5, 6, 7, 10, 15 years ago, because everything's archived now. And some of the stuff that people have said is just unbelievable. And I can't believe those people still have jobs. So I'll give you an example here, and I won't do my current affair voice this time, but property prices set to plummet, okay? Even Domain thinks Aussie house prices are gonna tank. Mortgage stress looms for borrowers who haven't done their homework. What else is newsworthy? Well, the earth has completed its shortest day on record, and the effects could be devastating. I didn't hear about that. It must have been that devastating. Holy moly. 7-Eleven coffee is going to increase to $2 a cup. That's crazy. Let's look at some more stuff here. How worried should we be about the mysterious rise of the tomato flu? Mortgage stress is surging in Australia. Here's what you need to do to keep your home. Okay, great, because they're always looking out for us. So of course that information is going to be fantastic. CommBank reveals when property markets will reach the floor. Because as history shows us, the banks are fantastic at being able to predict when the market's going to hit its peak and hit its low. This is a good one. Why you should never buy peanut butter in plastic jars. Last time I checked, most peanut butter companies sell them in plastic jars. Why don't the peanut butter companies know about this? The worst is yet to come for the housing market. Wipeout. Aussies taking a $110,000 hit on property prices. CBA says the RBA is flying blind with aggressive rate hikes. All right, let's keep looking now. Now, if you read enough news like me, you can often find some less polarizing and more useful information. Here's one. Big banks drop their variable mortgage rates. Wow, I'm not hearing a lot about that, or they're definitely not telling me that in the news. Jerry Harvey says that house price gloom is overdone. I'd probably agree with you, Jerry. Buying a house is not that much more affordable, except in a few affluent pockets. Well, that makes sense because those more affluent suburbs typically will demand a premium. And usually when the market drops, those prices go down because they're already inflated. New lenders grab top spots for cheapest loans. Well, that makes total sense to me because you're going to get a lot of new lenders coming out there realizing they can capture some market share by not gouging people's eyes out with these ridiculous rate increases. Australia raises permanent migration cap to 195,000 to ease workforce shortages. Well, that makes a lot of sense because retail, hospitality, and tourism areas are where we probably have had been the most affected during coronavirus. And typically people from overseas and immigrants are usually the ones doing those more lower paying jobs when they first come into our country. So again, some of that stuff makes sense. But I would still read the whole article because I'd want to understand what's actually going on there. I just shared with you my preconceived notions and my logic based upon those headlines. But after reading the articles, it could be totally the opposite. Now, the problem with this overload of information is that Aussies spend too much time searching and not enough time researching. With all the fear-mongering in the media, now is a great time to buy. I've said that before, and I said that in 2020. More stock on the market, less competition, and sellers more willing to negotiate. If you've been waiting and you plan on being in it for the long term, get out there and buy something. What are you waiting for? Okay. I wanted to share with you some of the recent purchases that we've made for our clients. Now, our buyer's agent actually saw this very appealing property come onto the market, but she at the time didn't have a client that met this criteria for this particular property. Excuse me. As soon as that buyer's agent got a client that met the criteria, they matched them to it. It was all about speed. Enormous potential, 678 square meter site located in a high amenity pocket, long-term tenants secured prior to settlement. So we actually got this place rented before we settled on the property, which was fantastic. There was no lag there. As I said, 678 square meter site with a 16.6 meter frontage, which means this property can be subdivided later on down the track. Good land value here. Located less than 11 radial kilometers from Brisbane CBD, walking distance to the train station and local shops, schools and parkland. It's a post-war dwelling, which means that it can be removed in years to come. And again, that's why that land value is even more attractive. Internal upgrades making it immediately tenable, which was great. We paid $941,000 for this. Now, here's the beautiful Ailey, one of our buyer's agents. She secured this particular property. It's the equivalent distance and demographic to, let's say, Roseville here in Sydney, where I am near Chatswood, where the median house price is about $3,800,000 with a whopping rental yield of 1.71%. So the property that we bought just then, the one I showed you, this suits a client with an above average investment budget, okay, who wants a high probability of capital growth from buying land in a premium suburb. Now, typically with properties like this, the rental yield you're going to get is not going to be fantastic, okay? But it's because you're land banking. You're hoping that being in a premium area, that land value is going to go up quite significantly over the short and longer period of time. So the client has no plans to really add any value to it. We didn't talk about subdividing the property, etc. We just knew those options were on the table, but that's not something that's in their strategy at the moment. This is a real set and forget approach because the property also was recently renovated, so the client's not going to really have to do much maintenance on it. Looking at the numbers, this is an example of how these numbers are going to work based upon comparing these two properties. So the Sydney equivalent and the property we purchased in Brisbane. So we purchased it at $950,000, $630 per week, 3.45% rental yield, which is attractive. Average house rental yield in Sydney is about 2.8%, and you're paying about $1.1 million for that. $3.8 million for the equivalent example here in Sydney, as I was talking about before in Roseville, you're getting about $1,275 per week for that property, but that means the rental yield's only 1.71%. I don't know many people that would spend $3.8 million on an investment property, but just giving you the equivalent example. Now, this purchase is a bit of a hybrid. The client had an average budget, but they were looking for an above average rental income. So straight away you'd think, all right, you buy a unit because the unit's going to have the lowest amount of land, which means it's probably going to have the highest amount of income. But the client also wanted some exposure to capital growth, and they also wanted to be in a good suburb. So obviously with a unit, you could get them right in the CBD basically. So they would be in a premium suburb, premium location, but they would have no land component to that purchase. So with this, we started looking at townhouses. Because as I said, the townhouse is going to give us some land exposure. It's going to give us a higher than unit rental yield to a certain extent because we've got three bedrooms rather than two. It's also for a growing family as well, or you know, parents with two kids or something like that. So it also makes a lot more sense in that respect. And lastly, like I said, you've got more of a house type of component to this property as well. We can get to a better location with a townhouse than if we had the same budget and we wanted a house. We'd probably be another 3-5 kilometers from this particular premium location. But if we got that house, we can get that little bit closer. And location is the main catalyst for capital growth. This property is a 3-bedroom, 2-bathroom, single car garage townhouse located 12 kilometers north of Brisbane CBD. We secured the property for only $611,000. So good price there, good result. This is our good looking buyer's agent guy. Now this, the picture that I put here of the agency that we bought from, this is not them. This is a different purchase that we did for this photo. And the reason I didn't want to show that particular agent is because, interestingly, the real estate agent that sold us that property that you just saw before, the townhouse, they underquoted the rental income of the property by about $70 per week, which is quite a lot. Luckily, our experienced buyer's agent guy, he knew what the property would fetch in rent. And he spoke to the rental management agent that we typically utilize and her services, and we knew what we were getting was good. So what we were able to do is we were able to rent that for an extra $70 per week, which was $3,640 more per annum. And when we were dealing with the client's mortgage broker, we were able to provide them with that information. And that really helped get the client's bank on our side and get that deal across the line. So the client's now receiving a 4.68% rental yield on that property, which is fantastic. Now, it's the equivalent distance to, let's say, Homebush here in Sydney, where the median house price is $2.75 million. And based upon my comparables, I had to try to find a townhouse. They're about $1 to $1.1 million for a decent one, or something of the equivalent of what I just showed you in Brisbane. The rental yield will be about 2.5%. So if we're looking here, we spent $611,000. We got a $550 per week income from that, which is 4.68%. If we bought a townhouse in Homebush for about $1.1 million, we'd probably get about $530 per week and about 2.75% rental yield. So you can see that that's allocating our money quite smart into that Brisbane market there. Now, this purchase is a different beast entirely, and this is the last one I'm going to show you. Unlike the previous examples, this property suits a high income and value add strategy. So these properties are typically cheaper, okay, because you're looking mainly for rental yield, not particularly capital growth. So location is usually further away from the CBD, and that's why price points are lower and it can suit somebody that has a lower budget. Now, the property is a two bathroom cottage. It's sitting on a massive 850 square meter block. Now, again, location. It is 60 kilometers south of Perth CBD. Now, it is in Western Australia's largest regional city and is set against a backdrop of beaches, and basically it's got harbors basically, or ocean that's twice the size of Sydney Harbour. So it's really, really attractive. And we secured the property for only $360,000. Now, you might be sitting there going, 360 grand, how much capital growth should they expect from a property like that? Well, before I go into that, let's look at the holding cost for this. So the client now receives $430 per week for this property, which is 6.21% rental yield. Very attractive rental yield. We're helping the client build a granny flat on the back of the property, and that's going to cost them about between $180,000 to $200,000. Let's go with $200,000, the bigger price point. And that's going to create a dual income property that will generate a rental yield of over 7% altogether. Okay. Now, as I mentioned before, this property works great for a granny flat site with approximately 3 meters clearance on the house's left-hand side and right-hand side with minor modifications. And we can leave the current carport that we actually have there on the right-hand side for the main dwelling and run a secondary driveway down the left-hand side for the granny flat. And this will give both homes their access points and driveway. So it does make a lot of sense. It's the equivalent in this location to Rouse Hill in Sydney, where the median price point is $1.410 million, with a whopping rental yield of 2.46%. So we're buying properties like this every week. We'd love to obviously play a role in your property journey. Let us know. Let's break this down quickly before we finish here. Now, in this example, I've completed my calculation without taking the granny flat into account. Let's just go with the primary residence, okay? So we bought it for $360,000. We're receiving $430 per week rental yield, is going to be 6.21%. Now, if we compare that to the Rouse Hill equivalent with a similar demographic in Sydney, we're looking at a $1,410,000 purchase price, a $700 per week income, which is only a 2.46% rental yield. Let our professional buyer's agents help you. For almost two decades, Providence have helped Aussies locate, assess, and negotiate their ideal home or investment Australia-wide. Stop procrastinating. Contact us today. If you like what you've seen here and you want to be kept in the know with the Australian property market, make sure that you like this video, subscribe to our channel. I want to thank you for your time today, and I will see you all next month.